Good morning, everybody. It's great to see the church really filling up these last couple of weeks. Really encouraging just to see people coming back in to the church again. But we are live streaming as well. That's exciting, isn't it? But don't worry, you're not going to be on television. The camera's just focused on myself, so it's just me that gets to be famous, okay? For you guys who maybe have forgotten who I am, my name is David Barclay. I'm part of the leadership team here. And welcome to New Craigs. It's great to see you. Just a couple of rules. When we sing, we have to ask that our guidance is that we continue to use our masks while we sing. But when you're sat in your seats, you're able to remove your masks. So just that wee reminder for you, okay? So obviously we've got our praise band back in the building as well, which is absolutely fantastic, and we will be joining in worship very shortly. But just as we start, I'd like to just open up God's word in the Psalms again, in Psalm 145, just the first few verses. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. So let us sing those worship words to one another as we start with our first song. If we can stand to sing, if you're able, This Is Amazing Grace, and we'll hand over to the praise band for that. please have a seat. So this morning we're continuing our sermon series and in the Book of Romans, and our sermon this morning is entitled "What Therefore is There For?" Now you might have noticed that our Pastor Adam isn't here this morning, so we're going to be watching. Adam's pre-recorded the sermon. Fiona has tested positive for COVID, so the Broughtons are self-isolating at the moment. So when I arrived to pick up the precious copy of the sermon this morning, they were getting a big delivery of from Asda. So they're going to be. So just keep the Broughtons in your prayers. Keep Fiona particularly in your prayers, and we just hope and pray that it doesn't spread in the family. But so a couple of things are being put on hold as a result of that. The Christianity Explored and baptism classes are going to be postponed for a couple of weeks until Adam's able to be involved in that. Other notices: Toddlers is starting up again on the 7th of September, on one day a week initially. There's been a lot of interest, a lot of queries about Toddlers restarting again, and we're really encouraged by that. But we are so grateful to God for this ministry. So the plan is for the Toddlers group to meet up this Tuesday, the 31st, to plan, clean toys and prepare. And if you feel able to help on a Tuesday, then come along and speak to Karen Frame or Megan Collard, who will be kind of taking a lead on that group. Another news, sad news, Janet Queen, who was a lady who was very faithful in attending New Craigs over many, many years, passed away yesterday morning in Victoria Hospital quite peacefully. So just remember, Janet's family, Janet's cousin is arranging the funeral, but we'll just come to the Lord in prayer just now and just remember that family and the other things that we've mentioned. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can be here in your presence. Lord, your word says where two or three are gathered together, you are there in the midst. Lord, there's more than two or three of us this morning, and it's encouraging to see the church filling up with people who are just keen to come and worship and be among your people. Heavenly Father, we're just mindful of just physical illness and sickness, Lord, and Lord, we just want to lift up Fiona this morning as she has tested positive for COVID. Lord, just pray for the Broughton family at this time. Lord, just pray that you would protect them and keep them safe, and Lord, that would not have a big impact on Fiona. Lord, we pray for Janet Queen's family, Lord, as they mourn the loss of Janet. Lord, we know that she is with you now, Lord, more alive than ever. But Lord, we still mourn her loss. Lord, we just bring their family before you now. Lord, pray that you would just continue by your Holy Spirit to comfort them at this time as they prepare for a funeral for her. Lord, she was a lady who was very faithful in coming to church, Lord, and worshipping here at the church. Lord, she was a quiet lady and a private lady, but she loved you. So Lord, we just lift her family up at this time. Lord, we pray that you would be with us as we continue in our worship this morning, Lord, here in the building. And Lord, for those who are watching online as well, Lord, we pray that they would be blessed by the time that we spend together as we worship. Lord, as we listen to your word being read and preached. And Lord, for every part of this day, Lord, we do it for the glory of our risen Saviour Jesus. Lord, we thank you that we can be here. We thank you for our church family. And Lord, just pray as we continue in our worship this morning, as we plan for future activities, Lord, that you would just be with us in our plans. Lord, that these would be your plans, that you would just reveal to us. Lord, be with us this morning as we continue in our worship, we ask in our Saviour's name. Amen. So let us continue in our worship as we sing our second song, King of Kings, Majesty. Please have a seat. Well, can I just have a wee show of hands for the boys and girls in the congregation? The under 12, shall we say. We just under 12s, or 12 and under, shall we say. Those at primary school. So I'm this little bit's for you, okay? And norm, you know, pre-COVID, we would get you all down at the front and things like that, but we're just going to keep you sitting in your seats just now, and I'll give you an instruction in a wee while of what I want you to do, okay? But it's just I want to see where people are so I can focus on you, okay? So who likes getting presents? Who likes getting presents? Not just boys and girls. Does not everybody like getting presents? No? Okay, I've got some presents in my bag here. Hang on a minute. Few little presents here, so will we have a look inside? It's not my birthday or anything, but we'll have a little look inside and see what we've got in present form. Okay, I love presents like this that are just easy to open. Eh? You just take that out and what's this? Anybody tell me what this is, boys and girls? Anybody? Will you look? Flour looks like a bag of flour. Sugar. I heard sugar. It's a bag of sugar. That's a bit of a strange present, isn't it? A bag of sugar. Right, well, we'll open this. This little one looks interesting, doesn't it? I wonder what's in here. Anybody know what this is? No? Vanilla? Yes. Vanilla extract, yeah. I'm not one of these posh people that uses the pods or anything like that. This is one of the Delia's recommended things that you use. So vanilla, that's a bit of a strange gift, isn't it? Okay, we'll open one of these ones. What's in here? Oh. Now somebody said this one a wee minute ago. Flour.
Yeah.
Now if you were to buy, you know, on Mother's Day, if you were to buy your mum a flour, do you think she'd mean that?
No? Okay.
What's in this one? Eggs. I think it might just be an empty box, actually, but could tell the Barclays need to go shopping, eh? Last one. I wonder what this is. Oh, there's two things in here. Hang on a minute. Yeah, I'm not entirely sure what these are. I think they're edible, but yeah. Decorations for a cake, yes. And one more thing. Baking powder. Now, this is a really strange gift. It's a really strange gift. Now, it isn't a self-assembly cake from IKEA, okay? It is really not that, all right? But it's just a few gifts. You could, on their own, you wouldn't really want to eat some baking powder, would you? Or what would you do with vanilla essence on its own? I guess you could kind of eat these things, you know, these little kind of things that you put on top of a bun. But really, on their own, they're not really all that good, are they? They really need to be put together so that you can have a biscuit or a cupcake or maybe a big cake. You want to put these things together in a cake, don't you? Or a biscuit. Do you know that the church is described like this in the Bible? The church is described as something that needs to be together, people together. And that's why, you know, as we said, as we opened the service this morning, we talked about how good is it to be together. It's been wonderful for us to continue to be able to worship while we've been in lockdown and not been able to come to church. But you know, there's nothing like us being together in the church. You know, the Bible talks us being like a body, with Jesus at the head and the rest of us all playing a part. The body has so many different parts to it, doesn't it? If something isn't working in the body, then you know all about it. If you've got a broken leg or you can't breathe properly, you know that the body's not working properly. You really don't want that. So on our own, on its own, baking powder or an egg, you know, I guess you could eat an egg on its own. But really, it comes into its own when it's brought together in something, doesn't it? Like a cake or a loaf of bread or something like that. So somebody with a plan, you know, a recipe, will put things together to make a cake. And God does that with the church. He's made a plan for us to be together in the church, all functioning together, using the different skills and abilities or gifts, as the Bible says, to be part of the church. God has a plan for each and every one of us. He knows what's best and how he can use us in special ways. And God is the one that gives us what we need. He gives us those gifts. And the gifts are designed to be used. So you might be good at encouraging people. You might be good at helping somebody. You might be good with numbers and money. You might be good with sports. God might have given you the gift to make things with your hands. So those gifts can be used in the church. Each of us has something that we can give to the church, and that's one of the gifts that God has given to us. Some of us have lots of gifts. Some of us are extremely talented, like our band members, and some of us maybe just have the gift of being able to sing with our voices. And some people can do multiple things. We all know people who have got these multiple gifts, and it's fantastic when they're in the church using those gifts, isn't it? So think about that as we just read that those few verses in Romans. Now, the mums and dads and grands and granddads are going to be focusing on this passage, and Elizabeth, she will be coming to read to us in a little minute as well. But just those verses in Romans 12 from verse 3, "For by the grace given to me, I say to each one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think of yourself with judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you, as each of us has one body with many members, and these members don't all have the same function. So in Christ, though many form one body, each member belongs to all of the others." That means we all have to work together, doesn't it? We all have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it's serving, then serve. If it's teaching, then teach. If it's to encourage, then give encouragement. If it's giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. So we're going to sing a song, boys and girls, okay? And I'm praying and hoping that this works. But what I want you to do, first of all, do you want to come up and get an instrument and take it back to your seat? So I've got some instruments at the front. So if you want to, you don't have to, come and get an instrument and then take it back to your seat. Now, this song we're going to sing is a song that has lots of ability to have actions, but I think what we'll do is we'll get the boys and girls to make a noise with their instruments, and if we just sing along, it is a video, it's not one that the band have learned yet, so we really need to make a lovely noise for this, and for people who are watching at home, this one will not come through the system because it's copyright. Okay, has everybody got something to make a noise with? I'll let Ali.
We're one body, yes we are. Head and feet and legs and arms. All together we'll go far. We're one body, yes we are. We're one body, don't say no. When we're with you, then we'll grow. We're one body, don't say no. We're one body, many parts. Jesus makes us who we are. We're
round of applause for the boys and girls. Okay, boys and girls, thank you so much for helping me out with that one. That's your slot over now. And before you head out, we're going to sing this song, Yet Not I, But Christ in Me. And as we sing that, the boys and girls will go out to their activities.
I'm The reading this morning is from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 to 8. Romans 12, 1 to 8. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing will. For by grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, in accordance with your faith, prophesy. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is encouraging, give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Amen. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Before we hear from Adam, we will sing the Lou Fellingham song, And Can It Be?
Thank you. Good morning. The last thing I thought I'd be doing is putting another video together to play on a Sunday morning. But here we are again. And I do apologise for not being with you personally, but we've been advised to self-isolate. Fiona has had a positive test of COVID. So do please pray for her and pray for the rest of us that we'll just know increasing patience as the week goes on. But we're here and we're in God's Word and we're in Romans chapter 12 and 13 this morning. So open up your Bibles and turn on your phone app and just get sight of these chapters as we go through them together this morning. Have I ever shared the time when I went to Israel? I may have mentioned it once or twice. But sometimes when you visit these massive churches, in order to get inside, you have to go through a small door, perhaps not as small as this entrance. This is the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. And this is supposed to mark the place where Jesus was born. Here it is inside the exact spot. But you first come across this door, and it's a very short door, and it's known as the Doorway of Humility. And we're not sure why it was put in like this. It may have been put in the Middle Ages to stop any enemy mounted soldiers from riding into the church and slaughtering the pilgrims whilst they were at worship, or whether it was put there as a spiritual statement. But you need to bend down low because in one sense you're about to enter the place where God became a man. He became a baby just like us, born as flesh and blood. But it's not clear, but I think what we can say is this: if you're willing to bend down low as you go through this small doorway, you will then find yourself in this magnificent, incredible building. And Romans 12 verse 1 is a bit like that. We've gone through 11 chapters of the book of Romans, and there's one tiny word which serves as a magnificent small entranceway into a glorious palace of what it means for us to follow Jesus. So as we come into chapters 12 and 13, we discover that, again, they are full of amazing good news if we're only willing to enter through this tiny door. Just look at how the Apostle Paul begins Romans 12. He begins with the Greek word oun, which means therefore. In other words, as a result of all you've been reading about in the first 11 chapters, about the fact that God has made himself known to us in and through his son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus means it's God to the rescue, God to save us. And we realize it's in the coming of Jesus, living the life that we could never live, and dying our death on the cross, being buried and being raised again as he ascends back to heaven. It's job done, all to bring us into a right relationship with the Holy God. And all that's been explained to us in the previous 11 chapters. And now Paul says, therefore, this is how your life can change as a result. And so this morning, it's going to be important for us to grasp what therefore is therefore. It's there for a reason. It's the turning point in the book of Romans. It's the moment, if you like, where Paul moves from what we know about this good news, the gospel, to how it's worked out personally in our lives. It's where Paul stops talking in general terms about the forgiveness that you can know through Jesus, the freedom as a result that you know as you come into that new relationship with God, and then you're given the power through the Holy Spirit to live out this new life, which then brings a new security when you realize it's all about God choosing to save you and hanging on to you, and all you're doing is taking hold of him because he's taken hold of you. And Paul has been explaining all of that, but then we come to this word, therefore. And Paul continues to explain why this is such good news for us. And you'll find that as we take some time in these chapters, that we're only scratching the surface of what God wants to show us. But we'll see that this is a promise of God, and it is so glorious and so all-encompassing that perhaps we need to spend some time reading and rereading these chapters. Well, let me encourage you to do that this week. As you read through them again, why don't you pray them in? And I also pray that as we look at them this morning, that we'll begin to understand what they're saying. And towards the end of our time, we're going to respond in worship, where you can say to God today, I want to go through that door of humility. I want to enter Romans 12 and 13 through this wonderful little word, therefore, because I want to get what the therefore is there for. And I want to say, yes, God, please change me from the inside out. You see, by the end of our reading of Romans chapters 1 to 11, the Apostle Paul expects us to be asking two questions. And I wonder if you're asking these questions yourselves. And the first question is all to do with transformation and change. And Paul anticipates this, and he's aware of what we might say and ask. And it's this, change, why do I need to change? Because all the way through this series, we've been saying the good news is that it's not about what we've done or what we do, but it's all about what Jesus has done for me. We've seen actually that it's all about God's grace, his undeserved generosity. It's all about forgiveness for sin freely given. And we've seen actually it's all about handing our lives over to him. So it's not about us, it's all about him. So why do I need to change? Yes, I know I mess up, I do things wrong, but we've seen that Jesus has got that covered as well. So what's the big problem? Well, Paul wants us to be asking that question, and he replies then in verse 1 of chapter 12. In fact, it's what the therefore is there for. So he says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper act of worship. Paul says, in view of all I've said that sin kills. Romans 6, verse 23, the wages of sin is death. Knowing that sin kills you, why would you keep drinking its poison any longer? I told you that Jesus died on the cross because your sin is so serious. Why would you carry on living in them? I've told you that Jesus came to set you free from the power of sin that controls you and wrecks your life as it stops you being the person that God created you to be. So in view of not receiving what you deserve, which is condemnation and God's judgment, in view of what you've been given, which is God's mercy, why would you stay in your sin any longer? And Paul uses another Greek word, logike, from which we get our English word logical. So when he says this is your true and proper worship, he's saying this is your true and logical worship. If sin is so serious that Jesus had to die to bring you forgiveness from it, if sin is so powerful that it will eventually take you down to the grave and eternal death, and that's why Jesus had to rise again to bring you freedom from it, and if the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord, why would you want to stay in it any longer? No, Paul says this is the logical thing. I've done a drawing for you this morning. This is a real treat. It's a drawing of me. As you can see, I'm not very good at drawing, but I really want to show you the real me. And so here's a red dot in the center, and this represents the Holy Spirit. That's how Paul explains it in the book of Ephesians. He talks about the inner man. The Holy Spirit now lives in the inner me. Maybe if you're taking notes, you might want to draw a picture of yourself. But with that dot in the middle, if you've trusted in Jesus, then the Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, now lives in you. So Paul says your logical act of worship is to surrender your whole body to worship as well. So from the life-giving Spirit, everything else then flows. Now, the other question that people ask at this stage is how do I change? How can I change? I want to change, but how on earth can I change? So you know what God's word says. It talks about being forgiven of all your sin. It talks about you being restored and renewed and changed. And yet you might even read Romans 12 and 13 and see it as just a list of do's and don'ts. And you might say, well, I've tried to change in the past. I've tried to become a different person. I just can't do it. Well, thankfully, God knows that as well. And that's part of the wonderful message of Romans 12, because just look at how it continues. Paul says, verse 2, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Don't conform, be transformed. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing and perfect will. And what I love about verse 2 and this whole therefore in verse 1 is there's an element of us asking God to change us. Can you see what it says? Don't conform, active. It's something that we need to do, but at the same time, it's something that is done to us. Be transformed by the Holy Spirit. Be transformed is passive. So it's both active and passive. It's a bit like when I drive my car. My car is old and sometimes it's heavy to drive, but I can make it go round corners just by turning the steering wheel because it's power assisted. But I have to turn the steering wheel. It's not going to move in a different direction unless I start turning it. But I don't fool myself that it's me that's turning the car. I've got power-assisted steering. I've got the whole mechanism of the car turning it for me. And it's like that when the power-assisted Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you. Paul says, invite the Holy Spirit to transform your mind and your heart and your emotions and your attitudes, the attitudes of your life, the way that you live your life. And then he goes on to explain to us what it means for us to change. So verse 3, for by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it's to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Now, aren't they great verses? But I also find them really challenging. And these verses are so relevant to me as they are to you. I don't have my life all sorted and all together by any means. And certainly when I read verses like this, I think, actually, I do often think of myself much more highly than I ought to. I'm full of pride. I'll put that word down on my list, the things that I need to talk to God about. Sometimes I think too much of myself and I think too little of other people. So we're reminded of this analogy of the body. Each of us has a body with many members and they don't all have the same function, but they belong to each other. They can't function without each other. But I know that I can be selfish. So not only pride, but being selfish as well. That's another word to put on my list. I really can be a selfish person where I just think about what's happening in my own life. And so I read these verses, but also God is saying to me, I want to transform you, Adam, from the inside out. You know, when I give money to an organization that is helping people in need, or I give to the church, I can easily pat myself on the back as if I've done something really good, rather than realizing that this is just my logical act of worship. And when I live my life towards other people, when I share my time and my gifts with other people, I can act as if I'm doing something out of the ordinary. No, says Paul, this is the logic. It's just the ordinary and proper response to all that God has done. It's your logical act of worship. You should be encouraging and giving and helping people and servant as you think of yourself soberly as you ought. And then he carries on from verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honour one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervour. Serve in the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Don't be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it's possible, as far as depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Again, aren't they challenging verses? But they're also great verses at the same time. But reading these verses, sometimes I think I'm too busy. I'm perhaps too busy to pray, which is one of the things that Paul highlights here. I find it easier doing than praying. Perhaps I'm too busy for other people around me who God is calling me to help and love and serve in his name. And so I can find myself devaluing others. That's another word that I'm going to put on my list, devaluing others. You know, I don't know if you ever do this. Maybe this needs to be included on your list. But again, it's part of this whole thing about seeing others more important than yourself. It's interesting, one of the alternative Greek translations of verse 16, it actually says in the footnote here, be willing to do menial work. So sometimes we can have an attitude, you know, not my job. Do you ever have that attitude? I can do that at home with my wife Fiona and the children. I can do it in church. I'm the pastor. It's not my job. When actually what I mean is, well, I'm being lazy. And I read these verses and I'm really challenged by them. And I'm also challenged by the way it talks about forgiving people, not taking revenge. And so you know whether you're living in the good of Romans 1 to 11 based on how you react when people treat you badly. You know, when people treat you well, it's easy to lead the Christian life, isn't it? It's when people offend you and mistreat you and dishonor you. And let's be honest, sometimes all the things that we do to other people, when they do those things to me, I can really get self-righteous, which is what the Bible calls sin. You see, I'm looking at this list and we need to take a long, hard look at our lives. I don't think I'm the only one, and I'm sure there's other things to add to this list as well. But I don't get discouraged about them, because these are the things that I can talk to God about because of what Paul says in these verses. He says, don't conform, make a decision to be different, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Allow the Holy Spirit who lives in you to bring about a change in you from the inside out. So it's like wiping that list, isn't it, off the board. Because the Holy Spirit lives in you, then he's able to deal with these things and transform you from the inside out. And so I find myself saying to God, I don't want to live this way. I want to surrender to you, Jesus, as my Lord. And I believe that you filled me with your Holy Spirit. And therefore, I believe that you've given me the power to live differently. So I offer you my body today, as I offer you my mind and my emotions and even my will, which is one of the other things that Paul emphasizes here. As I offer you the whole of me, I want to say to you, God, would you transform me? And just like the power assisted steering in my car, as I make one step towards you, God, the Holy Spirit actually makes 10 steps towards me. So would you transform me from the inside out? You know, I've got so much on my list that perhaps I just want to turn into worship. And so at this point, we're just going to sing. And then we're going to look at Romans 13. So let's stand together and sing if you're able. And then we're going to look at Romans 13. And then we're going to see the thing that enables us to change. So I hope we've seen this morning what the therefore is there for. We've talked about what the Apostle Paul says, that why would you want to continue to live in your sin from the past? Why wouldn't you want to step into the new life that God has got for you? And I'm saying that to you if you've been a Christian for many years, or you would say this morning, well, I'm not a Christian. Well, this is for you as well. And more to the point, we've been talking about how God has given us power to change from the inside out, the Holy Spirit enabling us to live the life that God has called us to live. So what's on your list that you want to change? Well, let's look at Romans 13, because this is what Paul wants to highlight for us, not to make us feel bad, but to help us to be hopeful. And these are really the areas where the Holy Spirit helps us to change. So let's read verses 1 to 10 of chapter 13. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of one in authority? Then do what is right and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to authorities, not only because of the possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honour, then honour. Let no debt remain outstanding, except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command, love your neighbour as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbour. Therefore, love is the fulfilment of the law. It's interesting, and lockdown has highlighted this, to how much the governments have been criticised for what they've done over these past 18 months, and perhaps even the ways that we've been dismissive of those who have been put in place to govern over us. And I found myself criticising and maligning those in authority. Perhaps that needs to go on my list. But there are other things as well. It talks about love. It talks about loving my neighbour as myself. I don't find it hard to love myself, but I do find it hard to love my neighbour as myself. And I don't know about you, but if therefore is there for our encouragement, if it's there to really encourage us that the Holy Spirit will change us from the inside out, then Romans 12 and 13 are incredibly good news for us. Because I'm discovering I've got loads of stuff that I want God to deal with today. And please tell me that you've got some stuff on your list too. So let's finish off by reading verses 13 to 15 and do this understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over, the day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armour of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. You know, as I read these verses this week, I thought of the word selective obedience. I thought of the word sleepy, which talks about here in terms of being ready to serve God or not being ready to serve God. It talks about being armed in the armour of God. It's what's described for us in Ephesians 6. I know that I can be so unaware of the spiritual battle that I'm in. And then it talks about jealousy and the call to rejoice in the good things that happen to others rather than being jealous of them, and the other ways in which we need God to change us. Now, the bad news that's often presented as Christianity is just the list, the don'ts. I've certainly been in a Christian context where people will tell you all the bad things you've done and therefore you feel guilty, but it doesn't change you. It doesn't change you from the inside out, and no one can change themselves from the outside in. You see, it's what the therefore is there for. Romans 12 and 13 are actually glorious promises. These are not God telling you off, telling you ways in which you're substandard, and because of that, he demands that you change. No, they're an invitation from God to get down on your knees, to go through the doorway of humility, to say, I'm going to take this little doorway, therefore, and I'm going to enter into the magnificent palace of how you want my life to be. You see, my danger is that I look at this list and I say, well, that's just who I am. But it's not who I am. This is what I once was before my old life died and was buried with Jesus Christ, before I was raised to life with Jesus Christ, before he ascended to the right hand of God the Father to intercede for me, and before he filled me with his Holy Spirit to change me from the inside out. And we can have an attitude of not my job, but the Holy Spirit wants to wipe that away by changing me from the inside out. I can be lazy. I can be unaware of the spiritual battle. Holy Spirit, change me by your power within me. Holy Spirit, I find it hard to forgive people. I can devalue people. I don't always listen to people. I can be so selfish. I can be proud and think too much of myself. I can be too sleepy and self-absorbed in myself. I can be too busy for what God wants and for what other people around me need. I can be jealous, but Holy Spirit, thank you for the promise that this is what you want to change in me from the inside out. I can love myself so much more than those around me. I can dishonor leaders. I can be selectively obedient and pretend that I'm doing better than I am. Well, the reason Jesus Christ came into the world is not just so that you and I could be forgiven of our sins. That's what the therefore is there for. It's a reminder that he came so that we can be filled with the Holy Spirit and transformed from the inside out. We can become the people that God always intended us to be. So I want to end with a prayer. And will you pray with me before we sing and before we respond? I want to pray the prayer of ABC, of admit, of believe, and to commit. Whether you're a Christian here this morning or whether you're not, we can all pray the same words. So let's pray together. Our God and Father in heaven, we want to come and admit that Romans 12 and 13 just highlight the areas in which we need to change. But we also believe that through the gospel, the power of God that now lives in us, we believe what it says in verse 14, that we can be clothed in the Lord Jesus Christ, that we can be freed from the desires of the flesh, that we can be transformed as the Holy Spirit changes us from the inside out. And so we admit and we believe, but we also want to commit our lives to you again right now, whether that's for the first time or for the thousandth time. We understand it's what the therefore is there for. And so we want to say to you, Jesus, take this life of mine, make it everything that you want it to be. Change me, Holy Spirit, from the inside out for the glory of God, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Such a rich passage we've heard this morning. Can we just respond in song as we sing our final song, God of Grace? If you can stand to sing, if you're able.
Thank you.
service is over. Thank you for joining with us. I don't think this week we've got tea and coffee just because of the weather. We won't be able to enjoy that outside. But if you want to have a chat with people, if you wouldn't mind taking that outside, but it's been lovely to meet with you together, and we pray that we'll be meeting again next week. God bless.